John teaches geology in Nogales, manages a photography business, and serves on the Santa Cruz Valley Unified School Board, Coronado Resource Conservation Development Council, and he has served on the International Boundary and Water Commission Southeast Arizona Citizens Forum. Take it away, John.
All right, thank you. Today, I'm here to talk to you about what I've been putting together since the City of Nogales back in 2004 abdicated their responsibilities to the county for floodplain management, which is a conceptual drainage master plan for the city. Now, the reason we have to go through this is very simple. We have Santa Cruz County here, Pima County, Cochise County. We're sitting somewhere more or less about here. This is the City of Nogales right along the Mexican border. And unfortunately, most of the issues that we have for flooding there tend to come up from the south, from Mexico. In fact, the history of flooding within the City of Nogales dates back to the 1800s when the city was founded. The City of Nogales is a railroad town. And like all the railroad towns in the American Southwest, they were founded where railroads found it easiest to move. They needed fairly low grades, they needed a source of water. That meant they tended to follow the river channels. And so wherever they set up, that's where you are. Just about every single railroad town in the American Southwest has severe flooding issues. The main sources for flooding in the city tend to be the Nogales Wash, which is this set of photos here. Ephraim Canyon, which is these set of photos here, and as well as Potrero Creek. And we can see those on here where we have the Nogales Wash coming up through out of Mexico, through basically the center of town. This is the Ephraim Canyon Wash that comes through. This is another wash called Mariposa, and this is Potrero Creek. So you can see that while in terms of the total area of the city, which is about 20 square miles, not a lot of it, percentage-wise, is really in a floodplain. The problem ends up being is that the vast majority of the development that has taken place within the city to date is within the floodplain areas. This is the downtown area that gets hit pretty hard. There's a lot of older homes along Western Avenue here. We have an industrial development which we've managed to reduce some of the flooding in there. And then there's nearly 1,000 properties right in here that are all inundated by the floodplain. So what I've been working on is this conceptual master plan to try to figure out how do we attack the issues of dealing with flooding in Nogales. It's a problem that dates back to the 1800s, as I said. Some of the biggest floods actually were around the 1900s and 1920s when the area was hit pretty severely. We've been lucky that the last really major flood in Nogales was about 1978, and then a smaller one in the late 1990s. But then we've kind of dodged some bullets, especially since I've been there. A number of times when the rest of the state is flooding, I'm sitting there going, where is the rain? So what we're looking at are a series of basins and some other improvement projects to try to address the situation. These are going to, the list of some of the projects, we're going to go through them very briefly, one at a time. So the first one is the Ephraim Detention Basin. This is one that we've actually been working on with Stantec. We've got basically a 15% design done right now. It's designed to basically take the 100-year deep discharge and convert it down to the point where the flow will pretty much stay in channel. So again, this is Western Avenue or Ephraim Canyon Reach. This is the proposed location for the basin. This is I-19 coming up from the international border. And for those of you that are familiar with Nogales, this is Holy Cross Hospital, and this is the Mariposa Port of Entry. This area here is a fairly deep valley section that just is ideal for the placement of a basin. And what we're looking at is roughly a 1.3 million cubic yard hole in the ground. EWR, had a wonderful meeting with us that lasted about an hour and a half, 2 hours, where heard nothing but good things about the project, and as we're wrapping it up, getting ready to go, they go, oh, by the way, you cannot build this, because it'll be a jurisdictional structure. Well, that's not a problem, we've got a spillway. Well, you can't have the spillway over the structure. The spillway has to be in native soil. So they were telling us, you're gonna have to dig your spillway through this hillside here and through I-19, which basically just took the cost benefit analysis from the project and basically blew a crater into it. Basically, looking at what we hope to do, though, is based on the initial engineering, and it's kind of hard to see, lighting's not great. Again, here's where the basin would be. This red line in here would be the effective floodplain after. That's the goal. Looking at that, we have approximately 239 properties, 250 structures that are in the existing FEMA special flood hazard area along Western Avenue. We estimate that at least 171 of those properties, or about 72%, and 230 of the structures, about 92%, can be taken out of the FEMA special flood hazard area, and that's at a minimum. Part of this is going to depend on how FEMA lets us adjust the Q100 downstream. Basically, the project would also have an impact in significantly reducing the downstream flows in the Nogales Wash, because Effort Canyon, where it confluences with the Nogales Wash, is about a 3,700 cubic foot per second tributary going into the Nogales. We would be taking it down to right around 350 CFS. So basically 90% reduction in discharge. Similar vein along Mariposa Wash, we want to do a large basin. We actually have the benefit of an old construction borrow pit from when I-19 was constructed that the channel is already broken into. The problem we have is it's filling that in, and there's no inlet control or outlet control on this, so and just kind of filling in. It has ended up reducing downstream flows to a bit, but we need to find a way to formalize this and make it a stable situation so that we are able to maintain or even better the situation downstream. This is the area that we're looking at for the basin. It's literally, this is the boundary line for the city. There's a little alcove here of private property. The rest of this is Forest Service. And this is the floodplain for Mariposa. And again, we are hoping to basically the same thing, try to keep it basically within the channel throughout the area. We don't have as much visible impact in terms of the number of properties and structures that are going to be removed, but we have the impact of the fact that all the properties that are going to be hit are commercial, industrial commercial properties that are high value properties within the community. And then we have what we're calling the Baffert Basin. We have a fairly large area in the middle of the city called, off of the road called Baffert Road that is owned by the Baffert family. If you're a horse racing fan, that name might sound familiar because the trainer of the last Triple Crown winner is Mr. Baffert. So, family owns the property. There's a 40-acre section of this land that they own that is flat right next to the Nogales Wash. It's undeveloped. What better place to put a large basin offline on the Nogales Wash and potentially have benefits for the city there? I've been in talks with the family. The family is considering the idea of this basin, provided that they get fair compensation for the land. They don't want to take it out from under them, which is completely understandable. So we did a feasibility study with Stanhead just to see if we put a basin here, what would happen. And this is the area here. So this is Grand Avenue in Nogales. Down here is Mariposa, the county complex. This is Baffert right in here, and this is the area that we're proposing for the basin, 40-acre basin. StanTech took a look at it, and what they came up with on the hydrograph is this right here is the current hydrograph for the Nogales Wash. If we put the bathroom basin in, it would, or I'm sorry, not the bathroom basin, but if we struck both the Mariposa Basin and Ephraim Canyon, we would get down to this hydrograph. So we'd have a nice reduction in the peak. If we put the bathroom basin in, we would be down here, about 7,500 CFS, which coincidentally happens to be just about channel capacity in the downstream channel. So if we build that, then basically we are looking at converting the floodplain from the blue to the red here, with the exception of what's coming in from this tributary and this tributary. We also are looking at some other design features for this. The Nogales Wash comes out of Mexico. One of the ways, unfortunately, that I can tell you how high the water was is by the trash in the trees. This is a problem that the city does not like. They are constantly after us going there and trying to clean the trash out of the trees. We're already doing that trash is 15, 20 feet above channel bottom. We're trying to come up with some ways to not have to do that. One of the things that we're looking at doing is the idea of having this as an offline basin so that when it mirrors in, we'll have a trash rack, sort of like a headworks for a wastewater treatment plant. We also looked at basically the way we could stage the ground in the area. We could also have it as a multi-use facility, sort of like the Pino Complex in Tucson, where they have some ball fields there. Soccer and baseball being two of the big sports in our region. Always complaints about not enough fields for the kids and the teams to be able to play on. This will give us some of that. Moving on, another idea we have is the Trail Creek Habitat Restoration. There is a golf course that was built in the city of Nogales, or what is now the city of Nogales, back in the 60s. Unfortunately, at the time, they kind of filled in a wetlands area. And so they have a court order from the Corps of Engineers that's supposed to be pumping so much water into this, into what remains of the wetlands. The golf course was run by a private entity for the city. That entity went bankrupt. The golf course has now been sitting fallow for more or less about 8 or 9 years now. Putting that golf course back is probably not financially feasible. One of the things that I would like to do is rip the golf course out and reestablish the wetland that used to be there, maybe even going as far as creating a wetland mitigation bank out there and help pay for the process. But that would also reintroduce the flood storage and capacity in the area, reestablishing the beneficial and natural functions of the floodplain, and should have some degree of reduction in the downstream flood. There's also the possibility of turning it into a bit of an educational center for not only local students, but other entities. And I recently learned that there is a movement afoot within some of the political entities of the city to take the old golf course building, restaurant, and pro shop, and turn that into a local children's museum. So we have a nice tie with that if we can work that out. And so this is the area here of Potrero Creek. You see some of the golf course. This is the building complex they want to turn into the museum. This is the area of the floodplain. Kind of hard to see it, but there's a little bit of wetland here. All of this area over in here is wetland as well. And then the hard one, downtown Nogales. Water comes in from Mexico. Mexico, for all intents and purposes, as far as I'm concerned, doesn't do anything about their water except try to get it out as fast as possible. We have no control. We can't spend money there. What do we do? The downtown area is just this nightmare. A lot of buildings that are well over 100 years old. One building, just to kind of go back on it, a couple of years ago, an electrician was tapping up a wire on a second story floor in a masonry structure, and the entire
east wall of the building on the second floor just can't get down to the world below.
That was built back up within a couple of days. So we have some concerns about those structures. And when we look at it, what can we do to fix this? One thing that we've come up with is, and we're actively working on this right now, is a Nogales hydrology study. To the best of my ability to research, there has never been an actual hydrology study done on the Nogales Wash in Mexico that would be in any way, shape, or form acceptable to FEMA, including what we have used for mapping. What we have used for mapping comes from a 1983 U.S. Army Corps of Engineers report that basically states that the hydrology is, and I quote, a statistical analysis of similar-sized watersheds in other regions of the country, end quote. So we need to do something else. And so we're looking at what it's going to take to actually do that hydrology. Because one of the things that we think is that when you look at downtown Nogales, Sonora, there are no channels. There is no drainage infrastructure for overland flow. And so we're wondering if the flow might be so restricted in terms of the density of development that there might be a routing issue that would actually cause a peak decrease, even though you have a high urbanization, which should cause a peak increase. So if that pans out, then we're also looking at the possibility of maybe doing some two-dimensional modeling of the floodplain instead because of the issues of trying to basically get flow through Nogales, Arizona. We've also looked at the idea of toying with the idea of widening the channel. The Nogales Wash existing channel was constructed in the late 1920s, early 1930s. It does not represent the natural channel in the least. It was a total excavation job. It runs through a couple of tunnels that come in from Mexico, and then basically a couple of very old concrete lined channels that then merge into one channel inside the city of Nogales. Those things are falling apart. It's a matter of time before we have a major disaster with those. We're just hoping that we can find a way to fix it before then. But widening the channel and increasing the capacity might help the city. And so what we've looked at is, how can we do that? Now the problem is that on one side of the channel, you have the railroad. It turns out the channel is mostly in the railroad right-of-way, so getting permission to do much work in that direction is a problem. If I can make the railroad magically disappear, yeah, you widen it. And the railroad is ready to move their tracks. They are willing to move, as long as somebody else builds everything they need, first and foremost, and then gives it to them for free. Deepen the channel. Maybe we can deepen the channel. Well, unfortunately, right underneath the channel runs the International Outfall Sewer Line, which brings at least 9.9 million gallons of sewage a day out of Mexico to be treated in the Nogales International Wastewater Treatment Plant. So unless you're willing to relocate a sewer main, you can't deepen the channel. There are a couple of roads that also butt up against this channel. And so the idea is maybe we convince the city to sacrifice the roads in part and turn those roads from two-way roads into one-way roads and widen the channel out into it. The area that we're thinking of is along Morley Avenue down in here and along Hohokam Avenue up in here. And what we did is we just did a couple of real rough back of the envelope type calculations. This is for along Morley Avenue. If we were basically, this is the current existing channel. What would happen if we were to just come in here and try to block out this channel like this, make it a more rectangular channel? Ran a real basic Q2 on this and found that we could increase the channel capacity by about 54%. So that would have some benefit. Then looking at up here along the Hokum, doing essentially the same thing, a little more room that we can work with there because of the geometry of the situation,
we could get an 83.6% increase in channel capacity. The unfortunate thing is that in between these two areas, we have private property. So we would have to do, get into a tank in order to make this work.
So channel widening, that taking that private property, that's going to be a tough sell for any of the politicians. Underground improvements. Maybe we could do like they do in parts of Tokyo or Las Vegas and have underground galleries from attention to attention. That's going to be really expensive to do. We have the tunnel issue, so I don't know if Homeland Security would be all too thrilled about that. And then also, as I mentioned, we have some real concerns about the structural integrity of some of the buildings in the area, and just trying to go under them and do something under that could cause those buildings to collapse. And that's just a headache we don't really need. Or we could go full Seattle and basically try to convince downtown business owners to abandon the first floor and move everything up before, because most of the buildings are 2 or 3 stories. And maybe retrofit the bottom of the buildings into covered parking, because like most downtown areas, what's the one thing you don't have when you want to go downtown? It's a place to park. It's a possibility, in fact, it's a strong enough possibility that we are looking into the possibility ourselves of trying to find a single standalone structure downtown that we would buy as a flood control district, retrofit to have it be a flood-proof structure with everything else on the second floor and fix the bottom floor. Vision-wise, I like this a lot, because then if I can convince everybody to do it, we can find a way to do it all at once. We could also do a skywalk outside the second floor of those buildings to connect everything, so you don't have to go up and down stairs all the time. But then you can have a skywalk, and you can take that skywalk across the railroad tracks. One of the big problems in downtown Nogales, train comes in, you can't get from one side of downtown to the other without trying to cut through the train. So they get a little antsy about doing that. Just to kind of recap on where these projects are, we have the three basins here, here, and here, the possible wetland restoration here, and some channel improvements or projects down in here. Unfortunately, the big problem is going to be is that it's easy enough to come up with a plan, it's coming up with the cash to do anything. But just the three basins alone are going to be probably in the neighborhood of $60 to $70 million. With the big one being this one, because it's just so much property to have to acquire, especially because it's prime property at the moment. This basin right here, we have an estimate with Stantec of construction cost of around $15.7 to $16 million. Half of that is because of pumps in order to pump that water out. So, you know, it's a start for us, but you know, the problem is that people have constantly whined and complained about the problem for decades. There have even been attempts to try to think about what to do. Nothing's ever gone anywhere. I want to get this stuff. I want to be out of the job, because there isn't a job to do anymore. And with that, I'll go ahead and take some questions. Terry.
First of all, John, you have one of the tougher communities to work with, so I'm sure. If you guys, one comment and one question. If you guys do buy that building and elevate it, very rarely part of the water surface elevation, make that a advertisement that just shops. And then the second thing, have you guys considered, I know that your budget is for wastewater, have you guys considered a flat type program, a flood coming out of that position program? Because what happens over time is you slowly move to get the parcel. But then there's a disaster. That's when grant money can come in because we've already got the program.
Yeah, I have thought about it, and you're right, our budget is small. It's about $1 million a year for everything. So it's I have thought about it. There has been some resistance from the previous administration, the previous county manager on that, about even doing anything like that. There's a new county manager now who was a little more open to that. I have not brought that up with her yet. Yes, Steve.
Have you thought about having a neon high water park? Shown every day, every night?
Not neon. Actually, one of the things I have talked about possibly trying to do is a series of signs, maybe going in on some of the street signs that the city has, and posting high watermarks for different playmats, including the high watermarks. And see if that would, you know, maybe bring home some things. One of the interesting things, if you go into downtown Nogales, is you'll see a series of homes that are all elevated 3.5 feet above ground. Every one of those homes is built between 1929 and 1933. Because in 1928, there was a flood that, for 1928 or 27, there was a flood that had just 3 feet of water in all of downtown the gas.
That's great. That is the impossible question. Where in the world are you going to be able to break loose getting those oranges in the snow? Have you made any new discoveries on how to even begin to approach that? I know for years, when I first started working with you, we tried to get IBMC on board, we tried to get water quality, we tried anything we could to shake loose those pieces, because that is ultimately
the
big problem.
There's a couple of things. I know Dr. Warren Norman, who I saw in the audience earlier, has been doing some work on some views down there. Getting FEMA to buy off of it is the hard part of it. But beyond that, we're looking at just fighting the bullet, trying to hire somebody to do it for ourselves.
Well, I'm here to tell you in a very candid, private discussion with ASAP here, the acting deputy of FEMA stood up there and told the entire audience that they are looking for more creative ways to provide solutions. So maybe that is something that will shape this in your administration.
One more? And be sure to read the slide.
What's the status on the sewer?
Status on the sewer line. I wish I knew. That's one of the big issues that is a real concern. The International Outfall Sewer Line has basically outlived its usefulness and is in, if you excuse the pun, poor condition. It needs to be replaced. I know there are a couple of areas where it's actually exposed, and it's been exposed in the wash before. And it's basically an old style, gravity held together section. And that line pressurizes every time it's a major event, because in Nogales, Sonora, they will go out and pop manhole covers to use the sewer line as a storm drain. We have actually seen manhole covers on our side break and fall only 15 feet a year from that. So I honestly don't know what the exact status is. I know the IBWC has been talking about trying to go in and do some sort of slope lining on it. But beyond that, I don't know.
Thank you, John.